myself a whirligig. Hi, and welcome back to Stream Safari. We are back at one of the stream sites that I think I came to about a month ago, and surprising to see how low the water is. There's an area of this bank here where I was filming a whirligig swimming in a pool of water, and now it's mud. So it's surprising to see how fast our streams and rivers can change over the course of just a couple of weeks. So when you go out to a stream, remember, keep in mind that what you saw one day might be different than from what you're gonna see the day that you go visit, especially after it hasn't rained for a long time or if there's been a big rainstorm. So today, we're gonna talk about how to identify the macroinvertebrates you've collected. You've gone to the stream, you have your bucket full of water and macros, and now what? How do we do this? So right now I'm gonna go collect some macroinvertebrates and go through a couple of different ways in which I ID the creatures out in the field, and then we'll be able to share with you some resources that we have on the website. So I will be back after I've done some collecting. Able to find a really amazing collection of macroinvertebrates in my bucket today, and I think I maybe collected for about 10 minutes. And I'll show you in the video where I sampled, but I sampled in both like a slow moving pool area or non-moving pool area, and then I found some really cool ripples and kind of got my net down into those rocks and dug around. So remember, from one of our videos, we talked about microhabitats and where some of these animals will be found. And to be sure that when you go to the stream that you explore all those microhabitats, including within the leaves, and on rocks. So now that I have my bucket of creatures, I have my station set up here. Now, in your household, you may not have a digital microscope, or you may not have access to a laptop, and that's totally fine. I'm just bringing this stuff out here because I do have it as an educator. We are able to have these items, and so I just want to show you what they look like in case you do want to go out and get one, or just see what it looks like. But you can find one of these large microscopes or magnifying glasses online if you search for it. They're literally called giant magnifying glass, and these come in real handy. The other thing that I have with me right now is a dichotomous key. And a dichotomous key is a way to narrow down identification of animals. And so scientists use dichotomous keys for insects, for flowers, for mammals, for fish, for trees, and it's a way, if you're not sure what an animal is, you can move through a variety of different steps by looking at the characteristics of the living thing that you're looking at. So I have one of these, as well as some really handy pictures, because there's nothing better than comparing what you're seeing with an actual picture of that animal. Again, all of these resources that we recommend, we will post on our resource page on the extension website. So let's take a closer look at some of the animals that I found. So as you can see, I have my white bucket here, and I have a lot of different animals. Now, if you can notice, some of these animals are not macroinvertebrates, such as this animal moving around. No idea what kind of fish it is. To me, it looks like a catfish, but it's really fun when you actually find fish in our frogs in the stream, because they're just big and they're really awesome to watch. But they're not invertebrates, because they do have a backbone. But I happened to catch this one in my net, and so I thought I would show it to you. So then we have this animal that's kind of whizzing around on the surface of the water. And again, that's an animal that I've caught before. It's one of my favorites. And it is, one of its characteristics is that it is found on the surface. So it's a surface dwelling animal. And we watch its movement, and it's actually named after its movement. I don't know if I can focus in too closely on it. But this animal also, one of its adaptations is it breathes through a water or an air bubble that it keeps on its backside. And so we will ID that animal very soon. So as you're looking in this tub, I think all the other animals are hidden, and so I'm going to see if I can scoop them up with my spoon while holding the camera as steady as I possibly can. Where are you hiding? I've got my white spoon. It's amazing. Okay, there is an animal in here. Oh, I don't know if you just saw that. But there is an animal on this large rock that I'm gonna take out and put into a smaller cup, and we're going to ID it together. There's its legs. This animal actually projects itself through the water by shooting air through its anus. So one thing I like to say to the kids, particularly my middle school students, is this animal farts its way through the stream. Not very graceful, but it's a means of locomotion to escape predators. So as I'm looking at this animal, we've noted that it has 6 legs, a 3-pronged tail, 2 large eyes. Theo and I pulled out 5 animals, but they're very bizarre. Take a look. All right, you ready, Theo? So does it have 6 legs or more or less? So there's 3 on each side. So there's 6?
6 legs.
Okay. Is it long or is it round?
Long.
Long? Okay. Do they have a tail? I don't see any tails. So it says abdomen is hard, plated, or skin is hard. Well, I can't tell. I think it looks a little wormy to me as it's coming out of the case. And so then I'm going to go down to see to number 9. And it says, pairs of fleshier thin filaments extend from the abdomen. Nope. So that goes to 11. 2 forked hooks at the end of the abdomen, which may be very small. Feathered or branched tail structures usually cover the hooks. It may be inside of a case built from stream bed materials such as small pebbles, sand, grains, or leaves.
Yeah,
so it's a caddisfly. So how many caddisflies do we have in there? How many did we say?
5.
We said 5. So we're going to mark on our sheet that we have 5 caddisfly larvae. So in our sensitive group, we had 5 caddisflies. That's all we found. And so I'm going to record that on the back that I had 5 caddisflies, which were in the rare category. And so rare is about 10 or less. Obviously, when we're doing our data collection like this, we know that there's probably a lot more caddisflies in the stream, but all we caught were 5. And so this takes into account that factor. In our moderately sensitive group, which is the center 2 columns here of animals, we had 2 dragonfly larvae, a damselfly larva, 3 scuds, which are like little round shrimpy-like animals, one crayfish. Can you pick up the crayfish and show? Oh, you have it in your hand. There it is. And then our whirligig beetle. And so those were all in the rare category because we only found 10 or less. So I'm going to count them up. 5 of those. And then tolerant species. So those are the animals that can tolerate pollution. We actually didn't find any, which is a really good sign. So this equals 40. All right. And so 40, after I've done my calculations on the other side of the sheet, means that we have a good to very good quality in the stream. But I want to thank you for joining us again for more macroinvertebrate and stream sampling. Go to our website and hopefully you'll join us on July 29th to do some more identification and we'll answer any of your questions that you may have. So we're going to head out and can you say thank you and bye?
Thank you.
Thank you and bye.